Let's hear from Don, Democratic caller in Sumter, South Carolina.
Hi, Libby.
Hi.
Mr. Turley, the chilling effect, I would tell you that the new generation, even some people in mine, I'm a 55-year-old guy, is kind of going away because people display their lives on the social networks like it's nothing. They tell all their dirty laundry. I'm amazed at the things they post on Facebook. And it seems that the only way to deal with the privacy is to specifically state what expectation of privacy means. Otherwise, the technology and the attitude of especially like my kids and everything is doing away with, you know, like you say, the goalposts keep slipping. Also, one question about the president's expanded powers. I mean, what can't the Supreme Court, shouldn't they enter in? I can't believe that the president can come, pull me out of my house in the dark of the night, and whisk me away, and I have no action that I can take. I mean, what is that? And why isn't the Supreme Court weighing in on this? This is really, I'm a strong Democrat who backs Obama, but I'm thinking about not backing him because of this. And I'd really like to hear your opinion. I've enjoyed you over the many, many years that I've seen you on TV. Thank you.
Thank you very much. First of all, let's start with your second point. It's actually worse than they're coming into your house. I hate to ruin your day. But President Obama just stated that he is going to maintain a policy that he can have any American citizen killed without any charge, without any review, except his own. He is, if he's satisfied that you are a terrorist, he says that he can kill you anywhere in the world, including the United States. Two of his aides were just at a panel a couple of weeks ago, and they reaffirmed they believe that American citizens can be killed on the order of the president anywhere, including the United States. That has left civil libertarians, you know, heads exploding because what is amazing is that you've got a president who now says that he can kill you on his own discretion. He can jail you indefinitely on his own discretion. And the response of the American people is one big collective shrug and yawn. And I don't think the framers would ever have anticipated that they truly believe that citizens would hold their liberties close. And that they wouldn't relax those fingers, but they are. And now the point that you had made about the question about privacy and the new generation, we're not going to get any help from Congress. Congress has never had a good record on privacy or constitutional issues. But the only positive thing, and I want to give you something positive as you head to work this morning, and that is the polls. We've had three polls in the last year. And they all show the same thing. The American people say that they are more afraid of the government than they are outside forces, like terrorists. So there's this disconnect. The majority of Americans are actually very concerned about the loss of rights. But Congress, both Democrats and Republicans, can't move harder against privacy. I mean, and this is part of the cynical calculation. I think that President Obama made this calculation early on. And decided that no one would be to the right of him on terrorism and national security. And he has taken the Democratic Party with him on that. So you have this remarkable disconnect where the majority of citizens are going, we're really concerned about this. We're fearful of our own government. And yet it's just not translating on the Hill.
Jonathan Hurley writes in a recent Washington Post op-ed called, Are You Being Watched? It's Your Fault. He talks about Congress, and you write that Congress has historically been indifferent, if not hostile, to individual rights. Few members are willing to pass laws to protect privacy over security demands. And then you also talk about, jumping earlier in the piece, how privacy is under assault from private companies.
Right. That's something that people often don't think about, is that the Fourth Amendment protects you against the government, and that creates this huge gap. The surveillance industry today is a multi-billion-dollar-a-year industry. Most of that's going to private companies, and they have become really exponential in terms of their growth, in terms of the surveillance they have over employees with the support of Congress. So most surveillance that people are under is not by the United States government. Now, that's dangerous, because what happens is that the U.S. government usually can get that surveillance. But the standard is non-existent. See, where the government needs a warrant, these private companies do not, in terms of much of the surveillance that they do. And you see that in England. England has become a true fishbowl society, truly Orwellian. They've got tens of thousands of CCTV cameras. Many of those are private. The government takes from those private feeds as well. Chicago, my hometown, just has about 10,000 cameras now, which is ironic. The great I wrote another column recently about citizens filming police officers in public. And one of the things I mentioned in that column is that the Chicago district attorney, or the state's attorney, has actually gone to court to fight the right of citizens to film officers in public, while the city itself is installing has 10,000 cameras filming citizens every minute they're on the street. So the government loves to do surveillance, but they really don't like citizens filming them.
Fort Mojave, Arizona, Mike, Republican line. Good morning.
Good morning, and Mr. Drake, good morning to you.
Morning.
Yes, I'd like to kind of focus the attack away from the president and Congress for a second and just talk about where the Supreme Court itself has made some rulings on what I call topically here flawed warrants, where, for instance, a warrant that is misaddressed, though the entry is made and some contraband is found, that being a mistake, can under certain circumstances be a valid warrant, where otherwise if the police fake a probable cause to gain entry into an establishment and it's determined that it's illegal, that's found to be not good. Now, to me, contradictory here is that the good warrant that was done by mistake is allowed to be a good warrant, though that's only statistically effective, where the illegal warrant that's made by police aren't going to enter an establishment unless they think there's something there, but they don't have enough probable cause, they'll just make it. All of those entries more are going to be successful if they get away with it.
Mike, let's get a response from our guest.
Well, you're right. The Fourth Amendment area is a mess. When I've taught constitutional criminal procedure, I feel like I've had to apologize to my students because they constantly are trying to say, how are these consistent? You have to say, they're not. The Supreme Court actually has done some pretty lousy work when it comes to the Fourth Amendment. And even some of the justices have indicated that this is a field that is inherently in conflict. Part of the problem for civil libertarians is that the Fourth Amendment is a beautifully written thing. It's very, very clear. It's to protect your person, your things, your homes, and it requires warrants. But what the Supreme Court did years ago is they decoupled two clauses. There's the reference to warrants, and then there's a reference to the term reasonable or unreasonable searches and seizures. They decoupled it, and they said, well, that means that you can do reasonable searches and seizures without a warrant. And they started to create exceptions to the warrant clause. And those exceptions have now swallowed the rule. Vastly more surveillance today is conducted without a warrant than with a warrant. So most surveillance today by the government is done without a warrant, without anybody looking at it. And the thing to remember about probable cause, the standard is incredibly low. The vast majority of warrants are granted. When a warrant is not granted, I got to tell you, there's a serious problem, because probable cause does not require a lot to get a warrant. But most surveillance in this country is now done without a warrant because of the slew of exceptions that the Supreme Court has created.
Let's go to our independent line, where Tom joins us from New Milford, Connecticut. Good morning.
Good morning. Thanks for the discussion. I wanted to make a couple points. Number one, the president was a fairly low-level law lecturer at the University of Chicago, so I'm not sure he's really even qualified on legal issues. Number two, I'm a part-time certified coin dealer. There have been a lot of coin dealers robbed this year. The surveillance equipment was substandard, and the police have nothing to go on. I think the police do need the tools to do their job, and there's a lot of tax evasion where the IRS needs better tools to do their job. How would you respond to those concerns?
Well, legitimate concerns, but I have to tell you, the police have a lot of tools today. I mean, I stopped teaching the constitutional criminal law just because, you know, it went down where I could teach it from a pamphlet, because every right seemed to be created with an exception or reduced. And right now, we have a fraction of the protections in terms of citizens that we had just a couple of decades ago. And so they have a lot of these types of protections. The problem that privacy advocates have is that we're trying to sell an abstraction. One that people, when they hear the word privacy, they like it, but it's still an abstraction, where a politician will come forward and say, do you want to nail the guy that stole your coins? Or do you want to stop someone from a terrorist attack? That's a very concrete thing. People can think of themselves in that circumstance. So it's always a false trade-off. Privacy always loses. And that's why we're seeing this radical diminishment of privacy in our society that's changing who we are. And the question is, can we really get that back? And the what I'm trying to say is that it's very easy to lose privacy. It's much, much harder to get it back. That it's one of those things in your life that once it's gone, you have a hard time finding where you left it, and an even harder time to find someone willing to give it back to you.
Jonathan Turley, law professor at George Washington University Law School. Jody writes in on Twitter and says, today's youth want the opposite of privacy. In time, they will learn.
Unfortunately, they will learn. That's very insightful, and that's the tragedy. That eventually, when you've lost it to such a degree, that you're left wondering, who am I? Who are we as citizens? There has become this detachment, this passivity. That's what I talk about, a collective yawn, that people aren't registering that privacy is one of the most important rights to you. It's what you really enjoy the most, but you don't associate those things with privacy. But once it's gone and you find yourself living in a fishbowl society, as we're increasingly do, then you realize a bit too late that it's gone. And that requires us to educate people and to really prevail upon Congress. These people in Congress will do anything to keep their jobs. That I think we all agree on. If the public makes clear that they can mess around with a lot of things, they can ruin the economy, they can do anything they darn want, but they have to leave privacy alone, they'll respond. But it's going to take us to say that.
Tying into this, one of our viewers writes an email and says this question: in the law, what's the difference between privacy and anonymity? As a young person, I can concede I don't have the same privacy concerns as some of the older generations. It seems to me that when I get into discussions about this topic, many want to have the ability to do things anonymously versus privately. When I pick up a prescription, I have an expectation that my transaction remains private, but by no means anonymous. However, many people seem to squawk online that they can't maintain their privacy when what they're really trying to protect is their anonymity. Our viewer writes, anonymity can be dangerous, but privacy is essential.
Well, first of all, it's an incredibly insightful question. I've actually written on this, the difference between privacy and anonymity, and I take a rather dim view of this distinction, because it's absolutely correct that people now more often talk about anonymity rather than privacy, and the reason is really sad. That as privacy has diminished in our society, people are grabbing onto anonymity as the only way of retaining a small aspect of privacy. That's why I take a dim view of it, because this is another Faustian bargain. That is, in a society that's a fishbowl, the only way to retain any privacy is to pretend you're a different fish. And that's what people are doing. And so on the internet, like on my blog, we have a complete anonymity rule. And some of my guest editors have really questioned whether we should have that, because people abuse it. People become vicious when they're allowed to have anonymity. But anonymity has become the last recourse for people that have no privacy, that are transparent to society. That is really sad. It's basically saying, when I go into society now, I'm going to wear a disguise, because otherwise everyone will know what I'm doing and what I'm saying and who I am. Think how that changes you. Think about the children in schools, by the way, who now go through metal detectors, have cameras that film them all the time. What type of citizens are we creating? Where they're raised in that fishbowl. They don't even have an inkling of what it was like to feel like you could walk in the street or say something and not have it recorded or played back to you.
Jonathan Turley is a law professor at George Washington University. His legal blog is jonathanturley.org. You can find guest commentators there, discussions about legal issues and their implications on society. Candidate Newt Gingrich has come out in the past couple of days talking a lot about the role of the judiciary